generations, mothers have rocked their babies to sleep with nursery rhymes, but mums would be shocked if they realised they were actually singing about the plague, religious persecution, and even prostitution. Now, best-selling author Kate Forsyth has uncovered the shocking backstories to some of our favourite nursery rhymes, and she joins us now.
Thank you.
We've been telling these nursery rhymes, Kate, for centuries, haven't we? Mm.
Some of them are very, very old, yes.
And what are some of the really sinister ones? Because I know I always thought that Wee Willie Winkie was a bit sus myself.
Oh, well, I have to talk about Ladybird. You know, Ladybird, Ladybird, fly away home. Your house is on fire.
Yeah, your children are gone.
And what, you know, what people don't realise, it had another two lines that said, all except little Anne who crept under the frying pan. It was actually a warning to Catholics after the Reformation. You know, Ladybird was a reference to Our Lady, you know, the Virgin Mary. And it was a warning saying, quick, you know, the royal forces are coming to burn you. And little Anne was a poet. Called Anne Askew, who was actually burned at the stake as a martyr.
So because these nursery rhyme is the old lady who lived in the shoe. We have our very own older lady here, Mrs. Robinson. Mrs. Robinson.
Get in there, darling. Get in there, like Grandma said. Get right in there, like Grandma said. Get in there. Hello, everyone. Good to see you.
Hello.
Oh, my goodness. I have had such a great reaction since I was on your program last time. I didn't know people watched it, but they do because they've seen me and they love me. So good to see all of you. Now, which one of you is with child?
Me.
Who?
Why? Are you saying the rest of us are fat?
No, no, I am not saying that. How dare you? Who are you? No, I'm talking about that dearest Sarah, darling.
It's Sarah, darling, yes.
Now, remember, yes, I'm sure people are giving you a lot of tips, but you can give your young son a little bit of whiskey or wine. I used to give my kids half a bottle to send them to sleep, and they're very fine now. So don't forget about that. That's an old wives' tale. It's free of charge for you, my darling.
All right, we're talking about the shoe?
Yes,
where
why don't we talk about the
shoe? Yes. Came from or not?
Oh, no, that's an old one as well, and, I mean, that's just rhyming. A rhyming
so nothing too
rhyme.
Sinister.
No, nothing too sinister.
No nasty
with that
shoes.
One. No.
Oh, okay.
My question is, why did the format of nursery rhymes evolve for something like Ring a Ring a Rosie, which is obviously about the plague and dying? How did that end up to be a little rhyming couplet thing that you sang to children?
Well, if you think about it, I mean, I myself have often been trying to rock my own baby to sleep and trying to think of a lullaby, can't remember anything. And so to sing them a popular song that's on the radio at that time in the desperate hope it will drop them off to sleep. Many nursery rhymes began as protest songs, as political songs, as you know, subversive rhymes that were only known to a few. You know, Bar Bar Black Sheep, for example, it began as a protest song against the king, King Edward I, in the 13th century, imposed this huge tax on bales of wool. And the original version went, the original one went, a nun for a little boy who cried in the lane, and that was the, you know, the shepherd boys that weren't paid.
Oh, love it.
Now, Mrs. Robinson, do you want to reveal the history of a certain nursery rhyme that's got kind of royal connections, please?
Well, I'll tell you right now, I was down at the Royal last night and there's a Mr. George down there who has wandering hands. And I keep telling him I've got no interest in you. He looks quite like that, actually. That's quite scary. Anyway, I've told him, you know, Mr. Robinson's been dead a long time and my new Mr. Robinson, the one that's powered by a couple of 9-volt batteries, is very, very good and that's all I want from him. I don't want anything else. But I do understand that there is Georgie Porgy or something like that. Lots of cake or something, or women?
Georgie Porgy, pudding and pie. Yeah. Kissed the girls and made them cry. Yes, Georgie Porgy was King George IV. He was obesely fat. He was at least 130 kilograms. And all the young, beautiful women were warned not to let him find them alone. And a little bit about him, you know, when the boys came out to play, he runs away. Well, that's got to do with the fact that he actually married a woman secretly. And then when his father, the king, and his ministers ordered him to marry his cousin, he did so. bigamously.
Oh.
Lots of scandal.
I love a bit of scandal. And Mrs. Robinson, you have a bit of egg on your face, if you know what I mean. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge.
Dumpty, greaty, go for. Oh, sorry, I didn't know you were coming back to me. Hello, Joe. Yes, I'm a big fan of yours now, my darling. Now, in the war, we used to have to do tricks to keep the gentleman, you know, excited and happy. And I learned how to open an egg with one part of my body. It's with my hand, with my hand. I'm a bit rusty on that one, Joe, but I'm still pretty good at the other ones, if you know what I'm saying. But I understand. Ooh, egg on my hand. But yes, Humpty Dumpty, was he an egg?
Yes.
Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. A lot of people are very... there's a lot of argument over this. You know, some people think, yes, it began as a riddle about an egg, but most people think it actually refers to the English Civil War and the fall of King Charles I. Oh. King Charles I was, you know, the highest, the most powerful man in the world, and then, of course, he was caught by the Roundheads and executed.
So would you say that these nursery rhymes were kind of like the cartoons of their day?
Yes,
is that what they were? People made
really...
them up to kind of understand issues and make fun of them.
And many of them were actually told by lower-class people who couldn't write.
Right.
And so, you know, they were illiterate and they would have these, you know, mocking verses about the people in power above them, and they were subversive and they were witty and they were often dirty. Mm. You know, and, you know, we talked before about how they came to be told to children, but it's quite simply because most of them are very rhythmic and catchy.
They're great. I love them.
Well, Kate's novel, The Beast's Garden, is in bookstores now. We're going to show you what it looks like. There it is. Kate, thanks for coming in.
That's my pleasure. Thank you
so much.